Ibrahim Al-Assil, I'm a fellow here at the Middle East Institute, and it's a pleasure to welcome you today to MEI, and it's an honor for MEI to host three leaders from the Syrian civil society. They are here in Washington, D.C. as part of our Syria Civil Society Speaks program, which is supported by the Asfari Foundation in the U.K. to raise awareness here in Washington, D.C. about the role of the Syrian civil society. Local NGOs and Syrian civil society organizations are delivering humanitarian aid, treating the ill and the injured, educating children, and helping to keep Syrians employed where possible during one of the worst humanitarian crises in our time. Today, we're joined by Hivin Kako, Reem Alhaswani, and Mohamad Katoub, who will discuss with us about the realities on the ground today about the state of the efforts about relief and humanitarian aids inside Syria. Now it's my pleasure to introduce them. To my right, we have Hivin Kako. Hivin, she is the executive director of Bihar Relief Organization, a grassroots Syrian NGO providing aid to vulnerable people in northern Syria. She has represented her organization at international conferences, including the London Syria Donor Conference in 2016, the World Humanitarian Summit, and the UN Commission on the Status of Women in New York. Ms. Kako works to raise awareness about complicated gender issues in Syria and serves as the gender focal point for the UN OCHA Health Cluster in Gaziantep, Syria. Previously, she was the secretary of the Syrian Women's Network. To her right, we have Reem Alhaswani. Ms. Alhaswani is a co-founder and program manager of Basmeh Zeitooneh, a non-governmental organization based in Lebanon and Turkey, which works directly with the most vulnerable and marginalized Syrian communities to fill the gaps in assistance and respond to urgent relief and development needs. Her organization empowers individuals so that they may contribute to the advancement of their society. Last, but absolutely not least, Dr. Mohamad Katoub. He is a dentist and medical worker from Douma, near Damascus in Syria. He worked on medical logistics from the first day of the Syrian revolution onwards, providing medical and emergency healthcare to patients suffering from starvation, injuries from airstrikes, chemical attacks, and other war-related injuries. Dr. Katoub helped establish several field hospitals in rural Damascus during the crisis. With Syrian American Medical Society, he has worked as a protection officer, and he is currently SAMS advocacy manager based in Gaziantep, Turkey. We'll start with Hivin for probably 6-7 minutes about her work, and then Reem, and then Mohamad. And then I'll ask each a question before we open it up for your questions at the end. Hivin, please.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you, Ibrahim, for the introduction. As Ibrahim said, my name is Hivin Kako. I'm the executive director of Bihar Relief Organization. It's a grassroots organization founded from the heart of Aleppo City with the start of the revolution. The initiative started by a group of doctors. Those group of doctors were trying to help the injured people in other cities. Then when the head of the board was abducted, they have to leave the country for their life. And as you know, the humanitarian crisis keep on increasing and the number of people in need to rise on daily basis. The members have decided to officially found the turn it to an organization from an initiative around December 2012. Since then, we have been working in different provinces at the north of Syria, and we currently serve mainly in two provinces, Aleppo and City, where we have six offices, and next month we will have start operating in the third province where we're gonna start providing health services. Bihar work in different clusters in the humanitarian work according to the UN OCHA. We work in the health cluster, the food security, the protection, and the wash, and the camp management, and the shelter. And today I want to focus on the size of the humanitarian crisis from the protection perspective. As we watch on every day, the protection is becoming a major issue inside Syria with the escalation of violence, especially the shelling of the civilians across the country. Yesterday, two hospitals were out of the services in Aleppo City. The day before, two were in Idlib City. So as we see, the shelling continue and there are too many actors involved. But I will leave that later for Dr. Mohamad to talk about the health and the attack on hospital. I will talk about protection and challenges we face on every day. The civilians have no right to live. That's why they have been attacked on a daily basis across the country. On the top of it, we're noticing that the protection is being sometimes isolated and is not integrated in the program within the humanitarian work, and that's becoming a risk, and it's narrowed in a way, because the first line of protection, which is stopping the shelling, we cannot afford it, so there is no real umbrella for protection. If you allow me to share with you, in 2013, when I arrived to Gaziantep, and early in March 2014, I came back home one day to find a young girl, 14-year-old, is sitting on my couch with a friend. She was sent back from Egypt. She was a victim of child labor. The person who took her to Damascus decided to send her back to Syria. And I don't know who's that girl. All I knew that she is a vulnerable, unaccompanied minor sent to a lawyer to be just shipped as any piece of items to Syria, to the unknown future of within this vicious cycle of violence. I look at her and I saw a quiet teenager. She's vulnerable. She's pretty. How can she go to the unknown future inside Syria? I tried to contact different entities inside Turkey to try to find a shelter, accommodation for her. Unfortunately, there was no option. The only option was one tent in one camp inside Turkey. The tent that has 12 beds, half of them for boys, half of them for girls. And you hear every day about early marriage, sexual abuse. And I looked at her and I felt like, how am I gonna let her go? It's not possible. And then how she can go to Syria, where she's gonna go? The father who gave her to be a servant at the age of 9. And the person who's gonna take her back, he didn't know even that the father, where is he, you know? So for me, I just felt like, morally, what shall we do? Eventually, I decided to take her in, and I was fostering for her for a year while I carry on putting her case for resettlement. Unfortunately, I am Syrian, but I'm also British. The British government refused her case, so she was not vulnerable enough. And that was so much irritating. How vulnerable the person can be to be unaccompanied 14-year-old girl. Shall we just leave her to the street of Gaziantep so to fill in the trap of any type of abuse? Luckily, the United States took her back. I have to reopen her case after the UK refused her, and the state have took her, and since 2015, she's here. And the reason I'm mentioning this is because we are too worried in the United States about what will happen to the immigrant, what's the case here. But at least for me, I felt like it was an achievement to have to protect one vulnerable person inside Syria. We cannot do a lot of protection. We cannot offer an umbrella for all the vulnerable. But that one case is is important for us because being Syrian and living in the conflict on everyday basis, these are not numbers for us. All the big entities have stopped counting the deaths. I think the last figures been counting the real deaths stopped since 2013. I think maybe when one day the crisis finished, we will find how many people have died. When we go and try to find how many massacres have occurred, how many dead bodies we'll see when we document. The numbers were too high for you and OCHA to carry counting and the number of the deaths. So that's it's left for us as civilians try to do what we can as civil society. So this is one story, one person, and this is a case that we face it everywhere. The example is from Turkey where we are based, but there are other examples. There are other vulnerable people. Leave alone that I am the gender focal point and we face a lot of challenges. Challenges that we don't find enough voices of women that who are doing the work. And the donors are not doing enough for accountability, for empowering women to include them, to have their perspective. Although we know that the majority of the people on the front line of fighting are men, and actually, it's the figure says that if you are at the front line, you are safer than being at home. So we are losing lives while people are at their home, on the street, the kids are playing, and the figures are out there. We don't want to share figures. I want to share one more story from Aleppo City for you. Last week, when I was visiting the UK, I talked to my team in Aleppo City, and I said, what do you want me to tell people in the UK? What is the most touching situation now in the areas after this harsh besiegement? He said, like, tell them that we've created a new dish. For those people who know Aleppo, it's the heart of the food in Syria. They're very proud of their food, and they love what is called kebab. So they are not vegetarian, although now they're looking for vegetables because there are no vegetables in the city. They are under real harsh besiegement over 3 months now, and it's suffocating. Before that, there was a small window, so it's been almost 6 months the besiegement is carrying on, and nobody can do anything. That new dish of kebab, it didn't have meat. It was created from burger and lentils. And he said, we are doing it, we're mixing the burger and lentils, and we are putting it on fire as a barbecue, and we eat it. And we try to imagine it is the substitute of kebab that we no longer can afford it or have it. So this is where we are. We find ourselves stuck that we cannot help those people who are in need anymore. Thank you.
Hivin, you mentioned that it's safer for some civilians to be in the front lines rather than in the cities. Would you explain to us why? Why it's like that inside Syria?
I mean, all the figures now shows that when you are at the fighting front, there is little is happening there. The majority of shellings is happening for hospital, for school, randomly for the houses. So that's why people are losing their life by just being at home because they will just find their house has been hit. Schools, where the children dies on a daily basis. Hospital, so that's why it is documented that now the percentage of deaths at the of the people who are fighting is less than the civilians.
Thank you very much. Reem, would you please also tell us about your organization, about Basmeh Zeitooneh, what you do in Lebanon and Turkey, and also about your main messages here in Washington, D.C.?
Hi. Thank you, Ibrahim, for the introduction, and thank you all for being here. My name is Reem Alhaswani. I'm a Syrian. I fled to Lebanon in early 2013. along with other Syrian activists who also found themselves in Lebanon, we founded Basmeh Zeitooneh. It means smile in an olive in English. Actually, we started as a very small group working in within the refugees communities in Lebanon, in Beirut, in Shatila camp. I don't know if anyone knows about it. In Biqa, in Tripoli. We do some relief, some emergency relief when it's needed, because we believe that we cannot move beyond, like we cannot convince like a family to send their kids to school if they cannot find food. So we still do few relief activities, but we focus more on education for children and adults. So in Shatila camp, for now, our biggest community center, we have a school for 1,000 Syrian kids, and also vocational training for adults, English, computer literacy. We have programs for empowerment, for livelihood, like small grants. We give small grants for women and men to start their own businesses. And also women workshop where they can produce like handcrafts, handmade handcrafts. Also we work on protection and wash. This is mainly the services that we provide in our community center, because this is how we like to call our center. It's a community center for everyone. For the men, women, and children in this community where we're active. For now, we have 7 community centers in Lebanon and 2 in the southern Turkey, in Gaziantep and Urfa. And also in 2014, we started implementing also, like, we transported our experience that we gained in Lebanon inside Syria. We also started community centers in Aleppo, Idlib in the north, and in eastern Ghouta, in addition to some activities in Daraa in the south of Syria. So it started with 5 individuals in 2013. Currently we're around 350 around all the 3 countries. Our Basmeh Zeitooneh mission is to is a productive society that can live with dignity. Our mission, what we see that we have to do, is to give the opportunities for those individuals so they can thrive and move beyond being victims of this conflict and start to be productive again, start to be part of rebuilding their future, the future of their country, either outside Syria. So they like. We consider this period of staying outside Syria as like opportunity for people to start gain some experience, some knowledge, so they are prepared for the next period when we go back, as we all hope. Nevertheless, this is actually not too much to ask about the productive society. We know that it's a very long term dream, and we might not see it in our lifetime. But in order to get there, we need the minimum standards of security. As Hivin was saying, that inside Syria, for example, we cannot ask for but we cannot ask for much when people are besieged, when there's daily shelling, when there's like daily threat for their life. You cannot ask for the people will be concentrating in the schools, that people are happy or excited to start their own businesses, which is they are, but then in one day they can lose it all. And they know that, and we know that. And also it's like, it struck me that we have to sit here and lots of people have to have like lots of high level meetings with wearing suits discussing about stopping the bombardment on civilians which is something, it's like amazing, yani amazed me that this is something that the humanity is not agreeing on, that we should ask about it, and like people should start, keep screaming that we should stop civilians from dying, from hunger, from shelling, from daily bombardment. So, yeah, this is what we mainly hope for. Inside Syria, this is part of the, not part, this is the daily challenges that we face with our teams, with our beneficiaries. While in neighboring countries, like in Lebanon, where most of our operations are in Lebanon, the problem is that the Syrians in Lebanon, we don't have a legal status. Almost 70-80% of the refugees now in Lebanon, they don't have legal status, and the ones that they have, it will expire very soon because the conditions to have a legal status in Lebanon is very hard. So this is whatever you try to do with the young people, with children, it's going to a dead end because there's no future, there's no hope for future. This is what pushed lots of people to go to Europe, to try to find other place to live, just to start to plan for their future, and it's a right for anyone. And this is what was called later like Europe crisis for refugees. It's not Europe crisis. It's a humanitarian crisis for everyone, for those individuals who are not able to find any way anywhere to live. And the problem now with the deals between Europe and Turkey and Turkey imposing the visa and Lebanon are not accepting new Syrians is like, it's actually Syrians now are trapped in Lebanon, in Turkey, in Syria. They're not able to move. There's like the whole world is asking them, just stay where you are, die as you are, and we will discuss how we're gonna stop the bombing and besiegement. And yeah, this is make me so frustrated. This is make me feel that I don't know if anything good will happen in the future, especially with what's happening here and what's happening all around the world. So I'm not very cheerful, but so thank you.
Thank you, Reem. I understood that you focused on civilian protection and that it's very important for anything, for the civil society to continue inside Syria, that we have the civilians protected and your projects protected as well. But in addition to that, what can the INGOs do from here, from Washington, D.C., or from other places in the United States and in Europe to make your work easier or to support your efforts to deliver humanitarian aids or to work on those community centers? You talked to us about them in the beginning. What's your main ask or your main point that you think will really support your work at Basmeh Zeitooneh and other organizations?
Okay. Actually, Basmeh Zeitooneh start to be a big organization. We're now registered in two countries and trying. We start to have access to lots of international NGOs, international donors, which is like a huge struggle, and like there's a huge bureaucracy in this and all of this action. So if there's a, let me give you an example. The bureaucracy is the huge problem with all of this. Like, last year in 2016 in Daraa city, so if you remember, in February there was a huge bombardment on Daraa governorate, and there were almost 100,000 individuals are leaving the are internally displaced, and most of them are living in the in nowhere, without houses, without even shelter, without tents. And we were working with one of our donors since this was in February. Since September, we were working on signing an emergency response project. It's like the materials would come from Jordan and enter Daraa, okay? Mm-hmm. And this happened in February. I spent 2 weeks asking the donor to just send the materials now. The people are in the field. There's nothing to protect them. And because there were all of this bureaucracy, the shelter kits and hygiene kits we were able to distribute it in May. Between February and May, we couldn't do anything just because of bureaucracy, because of contracts and people are in holidays and no one is here to sign the. It was it is the thing that everyone is, they is all the Syrian responders on the ground are they dealing with. There's no contingency plan. Now they are thinking about the international NGOs are thinking about the contingency plan, how we plan to avoid all of these delays. But in all cases, until now, with all the planning, we were not faster than 1 month. In the from outside, from or at least 3 weeks from the international, from outside. There's always the first responders on the ground, which is the local groups, which is the local community, who's usually hosting the internally displaced people. And this is what the international community should do. Should start engage those locals on the ground more. Those small groups who are not able to get funding because they don't meet the criteria of the international donors and international NGOs. There should be built a real partnership between the donors outside and those groups inside. They should be heard more. They should participate in designing the kind of the way of responding that we want to do. And so Basmeh Zeitooneh is trying to do some effort regarding this. So now we're starting with other organizations, some kind of incubator for small groups inside Syria, so we can help them to implement. It's not like also a capacity building, because capacity building is a capacity building. I mean, it's a capacity building by doing. And they will be learning by how to deal with the donors and how to develop, how to get registered outside by actually implementing the projects inside Syria. Because usually also international organizations, they provide capacity buildings for groups, but usually it's only to teach you how to do their job, not how to actually be managing your own stuff. So yeah.
Thank you very much, Reem. Mohamad, after you tell us about your work at SAMS and your projects, also through your work with the United Medical Office in Eastern Ghouta, would you also share with us some information about the situation on the ground in the Ghouta area and in Aleppo, in Eastern Aleppo, the hospitals, the medical work situation there?
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Ibrahim, and thank you for coming. I'm Mohamad Katoub. I'm a dentist from East Ghouta. It's one of the besieged areas in Syria, just 10 kilometers away from the capital, Damascus. I fled out of the country in May 2014, and I work now for the Syrian American Medical Society. I'm the advocacy manager for SAMS. So thank God I'm away of all this bureaucracy that Reem was talking about. Our grants and program managers are completely filled in details and numbers. And Reem mentioned that the people in suits are deciding on behalf of us. Actually, she hates the people in suits and ties who are coming, the audits coming. It's not about the people who are taking, not me. And we were walking yesterday, and she said, I hold those guys in ties and suits. And I looked at him. Do you mean me? No, not you, ma'am. Actually, she started from audits coming to investigate that there is no corruption for a grant of $100,000, and they take about $50,000 to be sure that those $100,000 is spent correctly. So anyway, SAMS is one of the medical organization work in Syria. We used to work since 1998 in medical education inside the country with the Ministry of Health and Ministry of Education. Till the crisis started, 2011, we started work in medical relief, and then we were kicked out of the country because we are working in the non-government areas. So we are working cross borders from Jordan, Turkey, and we are working with the refugees in Lebanon. We have 106 health facilities on the ground, and we have 1,700 health workers supported by our organization. It's one of several medical organizations working in Syria, cross borders, have big staff inside the country, trying to filling to fill the gap, because there is a huge gap, and you know, health is basic need. No one can live without health services. As the government is not providing those services, civil society and NGOs have to do this, have to fill a huge gap. And in 2012, it was like a point where we moved from filling the gaps to provide comprehensive health services. We found ourselves not just treating the injuries of wars. We found ourselves providing comprehensive birth centers, dialysis unit, intensive care units, ambulatory, and we have to plan also. And here, all of this because there is no structure. There is no government structure, I mean. The interim government couldn't do this, even though now the health directorates in many governors are doing this job, but they have no fund. And you know, one example about how fund goes to support this structure, we completely understand under those severe attacks, no donor will be comfortable to support the infrastructure. But at least we can have a health directorate, a ministry of health for the non-government areas to plan and to coordinate all of this. The United States government invests in supporting local governors and civil society groups about $20 to $25 million a year. During 2015, United States government spent $400 million in medical, in relief in general, in humanitarian aid. So here there is no structure to coordinate those $400 million in humanitarian aid. Completely agree that NGOs have to do this, but without a government in those areas, you cannot be sure that those services are coordinated and managed in well system. And this is just one challenges, and it's not at the top of the list of the challenges that NGOs are facing in the country. Brahim mentioned the situation. I believe who is following up in the Middle East and Syria is fully aware about that the attacks on civilians and on the health infrastructure is very concerning, especially last few months. Now in Aleppo, you know, Aleppo city is besieged. Is Ghouta have been besieged since 2012. Even though the situation is Ghouta, about besiegement much easier because there's some local resources. Is Ghouta have agriculture, and people used to live in siege, and people could within 4 years develop alternatives to live. And there is at least wood to burn in winter. East Aleppo, there is no woods. There is no agriculture. There is no trees. So winter will be a disaster for the people in Aleppo if no international movement could save them, could break the siege. The challenges here, the main challenges for humanitarian worker in general and especially medical worker is the attacks on the humanitarian infrastructure, especially health facilities. And you hear about health facilities more than schools because we have been documenting this. Why? Because since 2012, health workers found themselves in the first front with the violation of human rights. So we developed a system for documentation, including attacks on health facilities, while educational staff couldn't develop this capacity. The educational staff don't have the capacity of documentation, but it's happening. But if we don't know and there's no numbers, that doesn't mean that it's not happening. As example, we, SAMS, one of several NGOs, we have 8 workers from the 1,700. They have nothing to do just to report attacks on health facilities. And we have others to report chemical attacks, usage of other kind of types of unconventional weapons, because we are on the front line of those, and all those patients are coming to our facilities. So we know more than other humanitarian workers about it. So this is the main challenge, the attacks on facilities, and sometimes people ask about the attacks and about how hospitals manage themselves and what we can do for this. Actually, we are completely desperate. We have no hope that the international community will protect those health workers. So we have been working on fortification of the hospitals. Fortifying the hospitals might help them in a way or another. But even though, I will tell you an example. Al-Hakim Hospital is a children hospital in Aleppo, the city. They have been attacked several times. July 24 this year, after the fortification, so it can be like mortar or a small missile cannot destroy it. But like if bunker buster or big surface-to-surface bomb, it can destroy it, but at least protect it in a way or another. A bomb fall, and you cannot put the generator, the electric generator, under the ground inside the facility, and also fortify the place of the electric generator. So the hospital was safe, the staff was safe, but the electric generator was destroyed. The city have been without electricity since 2012. It's a children's hospital. We have incubators. The staff tried to deliver the infants, the newborn, to another children's hospital where we have incubators, but the mess that time, the confusion of the staff, they couldn't save all the infants. Four infants die, newborn, few days old, died because of an attack on an electric generator. And this is an example of how it's happening. And then we announced the attack. A few days later, it was attacked again. And we announced another attack on the same hospital. And the other challenge is the access to health, access to health services, how we can provide aid. There's about 1 million in Syria are besieged. The same day when the hospital was attacked, when Hakim Hospital was attacked and we lost those four infants, and conjoined twins were born in East Ghouta, one of the besieged area. And actually for me, it was like God is sending messages. Yes, we lost in our hospital those four infants, those conjoined, and we saw their photo. They were like a heart. They were like conjoined, and they were exactly like a heart, like the... And I love them. I love the infants. I was trying to evacuate them, pushing everyone to evacuate them from this besieged area to get treatment. And such type of treatment is not available in the whole of Syria, even in the government areas. So the nearest one is Riyadh. Riyadh was interested. The State Department here was interested. Ambassador Samantha Bauer was sending messages, following up, what's happening? Please tell us how we can help. French embassy was interested. A human trafficker called me, and he said, for free, I can smuggle them outside. I don't want money. I love those kids. But the Ministry of Foreign Affairs refused. They were delivered from this besieged area to a government area. So here we don't have this tense between two parties smuggling. They were in the government, but because they are from a besieged area, because their father is from a besieged area, they were stuck. And they didn't want to take them to Riyadh, because Riyadh is an enemy for Syria, because U.S. is an enemy for the Syrian government. So no, they were looking. And I was like sending messages from under the table. Well, the Iranian might be interested. The Russian might be have such a capacity. And I know they don't have such a capacity. I'm not sure, because there were a lot of doctors who studied medicine in Russia, and we know that the Russian health system is developed enough to do this, but I'm not sure, because we don't have a lot of contacts there. But they died because of lack of access. So those two challenges actually are the main one, access and attacks on health facilities. And then in the fall of 2015, you are aware that there was a lot of efforts to stop the hostilities, and the International Syria Support Group was created, led by the U.S. and Russia, and other 17 countries, France, U.K., Lebanon, Jordan, Egypt, Italy, etc. and they created a humanitarian task force. The main mandate of this humanitarian task force is to be sure that humanitarian aid is improved in the country, access to aid is improved, and civilians are protected. Well, during 2015, the rate of attacks on health facilities is an attack every 4 days. During 2016, it's an attack every 24 hours. During 2015, till February actually, 2016, according to UN OCHA, the number of besieged population were 450,000 people, and according to UN OCHA also, it's now, last October estimation, is 970,000 people. It's doubled. So this is complete failure from the international community, from the ISSG, led by the US and the Russian. The Russian also, at least, we don't have any hope to stop this war. This is completely away from what I'm talking. At least humanitarian aid is away from this. At least civilians can have access to aid. At least humanitarian workers are protected and can work. As Reem said, if we have a safe space to work, we can do a lot. But we don't have this space. So our message here, I don't know what type of message is, but this is a failure, so let them try to do another thing. The ISSG failed. We know that at the end there's political interest in everything, but we are talking about a just aid and health workers, humanitarian workers in general, protection. This is our main request. How can they do this? We don't know. We are civil society. We don't know the Middle East Institute have been making sessions for us with experts in the policy in the Middle East. Actually, for us, it's too hard to understand all of this. Iran interest in Syria, Russian interest, Turkey, Qatar. What are the, sorry, but this, I'm a dentist here. I can't. So. Thank you very much. What you can help us is to raise awareness every place of what's happening in Syria, raise awareness about the protection of health workers, about the bureaucracy that Reem told you about, and about what's happening now specifically in East Ghouta and Aleppo. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mohamad. Let's open it up for questions. If you have a question, there is a mic. Please start with your name and affiliation, please, sir.
I'm Peter Humphrey. I'm an intelligence analyst and a broadcaster and a former diplomat. Just a suggestion. I think one thing that's lacking here is letting the Russian people know what their military is doing, what their sons are doing, literally their sons. Because when I look at Russian media, even underground media, you don't see the horrible pictures that occasionally show up in the Western press. And I think the NGOs on the ground can do a much better job, a very good job, of actually spiking of emplacement of the horrors into Russian media. Maybe you can work with Naomi Shams to do that. He's very good about that. And at some point, there'll be a sort of a guilt within the Russian population. You know, we're all for our geopolitical power, but this is crossing a line. It breaks every single Geneva Convention. The question I have, Hezbollah is operating some of those artillery pieces, Pazdaran artillery pieces. And so on one side of the border, you have Hezbollah actually killing your citizens. And then on the other side of the border, we have Hezbollah ascendant in Lebanon. And I see those two curves at some point pretty soon conflicting. And I'm wondering if you're feeling pressure now from Hezbollah, or do you see a time not too far off when Hezbollah will not look fondly upon your activities?
Mohamad, would you like to take that question? You worked in Ghouta.
Well, I was more concerned about her organization. So.
Oh, okay, sure.
Regarding Hezbollah, I will answer, but not your answer regarding the first part.
Let Basmeh, I believe that your comment is very correct and in place. And we don't have a lot of reach to Russian media. As example, today I have an interview with RT, and it was like a struggle. How could you bring this information? We have 170 health workers in Aleppo. How could you improve that this is a Russian airplane? Oh, the Russian Minister of Defense announced that they are attacking Aleppo. So it's not me. It's not me that I'm saying that the Russian is attacking us. You are saying this. Putin said this. So if Putin is lying, it's not.
The U.S. knows every plane that's taking off, where it goes, and when it goes back to base. That data is very well known.
Yeah, actually, the Russian continued sharing their drone photos and the location of their attacks till we could clarify that many of those attacks are civilian places and hospitals. And then the Commission of Inquiry report came condemning those attacks and clarifying that there were no military operation around those locations. So they were scared and they are not sharing anything now. So I appreciate your comment. Actually, we have very limited access to Russian media, and it might even we believe that Russia is not a place where people have power, but it makes sense that they can make some pressure. They can help us. And I do believe that Russian people will not agree on this. No people will agree. Just governments agree, but people will not agree in any place that a doctor was killed just because he's a doctor.
So your question was how we actually operate.
Is Hezbollah going to make your life miserable since they're the ones who are doing some of the shelling?
They are already. Are I come from a town which is occupied by Hezbollah currently, and it's close to the Lebanese border. But anyway, in I don't know if this is working. In
you mean your town in Syria?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. In Lebanon, we have a high security concern in Lebanon. Actually, we don't talk on media in the Middle East that we work inside Syria. Actually, inside Syria, we use a different name, because on the ground, and even some of our teams in Lebanon, they don't know that we operate in Syria, because mainly we have Hezbollah. And also because a high percentage of our teams in Lebanon can still go back to regime-controlled areas, to Damascus and other parts. So this is, if linking those names together will put a high risk on them. Actually, this is the first time I'm talking in a publicly about our work in Syria. But I had to. I had to consult my team, but. Then we have to speak about it, and I have to say that to talk about our work in Syria, but it is a high risk for us.
Okay, another question, please.
Sorry. My name is Hakim Said, and I'm running an NGO in Washington. And I'm ashamed to say, I went to Gaziantep. And I was there, I was eating a lot of kebab. I'm ashamed to see you say that. I blame everything on Washington. What's going on in Syria? It wasn't my first time going there. I was 17 years old. I went to Halab, Aleppo, and I called myself Halabi and Balushi. I'm just appealing to each one of you who's here, to our guest. I have a little office, a little place here. Work it together. NGO is not helping much in Turkey. I've seen that. I went there. I spent months with them. Unfortunately, I got my own excuse right now. I put them down. I'm ashamed of myself.
Do you have a question, sir, please?
The question is how we can help here. Do we get enough help from the U.S. Population? Because I saw today in the news a little boy want to give his toys, but he was at the White House. I just make comment. And I'm just saying, please, to each one of you, I have a little office here, how we could work it together. Thank you.
Actually, I agree. Like Mr. Kerry one time said, the international community is not helping in. And who is the international? If Kerry is saying the international community, who is the international community? Let's identify who is the international community. It's something doesn't exist, and we can't always blame it. The international community. Yes, the United States government didn't help. The policy of the United States government keeping silence away and just. Like if I wanna, I was trying last few weeks to make an invoice to the ISSG, led by the US itself. What did you do within a year? Well, the report is not just meetings. I wanted impact on the ground. There is no impact. For the NGOs, what we can do, we are trying to make advocacy. We are not the expert in this. Syrians are learning. We don't have big communities here. We are trying what we can do. And you know, you cannot gather 15 Syrians in the same place. Every one of them want to lead. It's not easy. So, yeah, I agree with you.
Hivin, would you like to comment?
Well, thank you for raising the point. I have actually a few suggestions, but I would like to start. You referred that the NGOs are not together from what you notice in Gaza and Tab. Yes, you're right, but there is a reason for that. The reason is when the head of UN OCHA stopped worrying about anything and only his concern is sharing information with them, and then this information actually not being used in the right way, when the numbers and figures sometimes are misquoted, it frustrates a Syrian because the NGOs majority are those Syrians who are risking their life, and they are trapped. I'll give you a few examples. 2 years ago, last year in December, our office was closed. 20 staff, including 5 females, were arrested in one of the safe area. And the problem...
Sorry, by whom?
They were arrested in Afrin, so if you do your math, you will know why they were arrested and by whom. And we were accused of working in areas that are under the control of different army groups and militia. So this is accusation. So we are, each side accused us by standing in the other, with the other side, and we are trading them, and we are intelligence, and we are all these types. Because when you ask from the donors to document and use a GPS, photos to document your work, then you are intelligent. So how are we gonna meet and compromise the standard, the criteria needed by our donors, by our funders, and the mentalities of the different militias on the ground? You know, this is a challenge. We are on the front line, you know, where we are risking our life. I smuggled into Syria last year, you know? And if I said that in my visa application, they will stop me to the US. But I did, because I wanted to see. Because even when you live in Kilis, just the other side of the border, with Tubab al-Salam from Syria, there is a different story. It's not what you see in the news. The camera cannot capture the real story. No matter how good is the photographer, you need to see the eyes of the people. You need to be there. Even from that line of the border, there is a lot of different story. When I went to there was an Eid break. I see the children are still playing with the toys, which are guns. This is hard to see, you know? You see the fears in some, you see the worry in silence, you see the pain. You know, you go to hospital to check your work, and then you see the different suffering. I got to talk to one patient of one of the service we are struggling to find funding for. It is a dialysis center where we are providing dialysis. Dialysis is a killing. You know, if you don't get session, if you don't have that session every week, you will die. So you will have a kidney failure, and then complication, then you die. And
all he was asking for me, holding my hand, can you provide us with epotin? Well, if you don't provide the patient with a session with the medication called epotin, that means the patient has to have a blood transfusion. So he will be through another type of pain, and that will happen every week. So these are challenges. To answer your question, what is our recommendation? We don't have an office here. I'm visiting, I'm thankful for the MEA, Middle Eastern Institute. My recommendation, we hope that the biggest funder of the Syrian humanitarian crisis, the USAID, and the US government will not cut with the new administration the funding, because the crisis is on the increase, is not going down. So this is one recommendation, one ask, and we will need whoever is here in the US to take that message on our behalf and remind them of that need. Secondly, we need also to improve our system. You know, we need to create some flexibility. I know accountability is important, but we need to also see a way to stop the bureaucracy Reem referring to, you know, because now everybody's talking about early recovery and start talking about building infrastructure. What infrastructure if you have 100 shelling a day in an area? We're not there. I know at there we need to think about it, but that doesn't mean that we need to stop the humanitarian access currently and the humanitarian services. So we need to make a balance between what on the long term, yes, we need to do planning, but however, we are not there, because actually too many actors are involved in Syria and the shelling. So this is the second thing. And I think we need to work together, and we need to find a way together, and we need to support the local actors on the ground, you know? It's, I mean, we don't want to seem like we are two end and on the boss. We are on one side of occasion, and we need to talk to the government who we need their support to be on our side, you know? It's we working together to deliver the service, especially the humanitarian, for those in need. Otherwise, we will not be able to carry on our work on a daily basis.
I have a quick comment here, please, about the role of NGOs. Actually, let's not blame the NGOs, because it's even not the mandate of the NGOs to be unified. This is why we are asking for building the structure. We need health directorate to do this. We need the local council and the provenience council to do this. While NGOs' mandates is different, NGOs' languages is different. This is why NGOs was created for, that to use different languages. Everyone is defending his own idea. Why to represent people, the Syrian people? We need the structure. We need the local councils. We need the local governors. We need to build the health directors. This is what we need for this. So I don't agree to blame the NGOs and to giving them more than the over their mandate.
The lady in the back, please.
Hi, my name is Malika Al-Iyadi. I'm an MA candidate at American University. And I was wondering if you could talk about economic sanctions and what effect they have on civil society, especially since, you know, the Assad regime really doesn't suffer that much from them. And mainly talking about how tech companies like PayPal or GoFundMe can help, seeing as PayPal blocks any kind of donations that have the word Syria or Aleppo or anything related to Syria in them. So I was wondering if you could talk about that a bit, either one of you.
Okay, well, about the economic sanctions, what we know that all the items importing to inside Syria, even before the crisis, were coming from India, Iran, China, Russia. Yeah, maybe the guys inside don't have luxury cars now, which is very good. But we have concerns about medicines. We have concerns about some saving lives materials. And I believe UN agencies are playing a role in this, in providing supplies. I mean the government areas, because the non-government areas are completely not depending on the local market in Damascus. The non-government areas are bringing their items cross borders from Turkey, Jordan, and they were before from Iraq and Lebanon, but now Lebanon and Iraq stopped. So the non-government areas don't have concerns about the sanctions. The government areas, actually it's always confusing for humanitarian workers. Do the sanction affect the humanitarian life? I believe no. I believe no, it doesn't affect. And we have seen several contracts where the Ministry of Health or even other entities asking WHO to bring specific items for them because they cannot bring it because of the sanctions.
Please, we have a question. Third row.
Hi. Thank you so much. My question is...
Name and affiliation, please.
My name is Mace. I work with Syria Relief and Development. It's a Syrian diaspora organization that we provide relief also inside Syria. As a Syrian organization, we know that we don't have to go to the political asks, and that's something that we suffer a lot here because we have a differentiation between the political ask and the humanitarian ask. But I do know from like working with Syrian organizations on the ground that they are like two very linked asks sometimes. And we here, we always, as a humanitarian organization, try to avoid that. How, like for example, like the no-fly zone, let's say. And I know that a lot of people are demanding that on the ground, but here we try to avoid talking about that. What is your answers when someone asks you about this mix between these two things? How can your voice be heard here? Because we totally have this disconnection.
Yeah, in other Thank words, you. Probably, do you consider civilian protection humanitarian or political?
Yeah. Thank you, Ibrahim. Exactly.
Sure. Well, we know it's... We are humanitarian organization. And however, we also know serious crisis is a very political crisis that has a lot of actors involved. The US, the coalition, Russia, the Gulf country, Iran, Turkey. So everybody, you name it, you know, and we forget in India, China. So everybody's involved. So it's political. And we... The need is to, as Dr. Mohamad said, like everybody comes, including the State Department, to say, oh, the international community. If Kerry says the international community, who we are talking about? So from our perspective, first of all, we would like the international community to stop the passive language and start talking with an active language, you know? Oh, hospitals attacked. Hospital bombed. Well, let's ask ourselves, who has access to the air forces when we are saying hospital bombed by airplane, you know? So it's very specific, you know? We can make our guess. It's going to be either the Syrian regime or the coalition, so which is represent a big percentage of the international community, or the Russians. So there is three active numbers, so we do our pick, you know, to blame who we want to blame. So if we don't change the language, this is an ask from us as an NGOs to start name who is responsible for what and the biggest damage in the country. So, and also the NGOs, although we work on humanitarian work, we need our allies to take that message who have the links with the different government to say we need an end. If we cannot always negotiate access. Access is always blocked. Who has the power to negotiate access for humanitarian work? We try our best, but sometimes it's blocked. And quite a few times it's blocked. And at that end, we need government to negotiate on ourselves, because each government is supporting one group inside Syria. So these will have the influence. So maybe we don't go directly. I don't mean that we go and speak to them, but we will try to talk to those who are responsible for access, who can negotiate access sometimes. That's just an example. So we cannot differentiate. We try to stay focused on our work. However, we get affected a lot by the politics and the complexity of the politics. So, and these two things cannot be separated. We try to focus on providing the services for all the vulnerable people who turn up to our hospitals, to our clinics, who are in need, wherever they're coming from. But that doesn't mean that it's an easy job for us to do it.
Before 2011, there were no groups like us active in Syria. And the main reason that we exist now is the revolution. And our goals was not providing humanitarian services, was not providing food and services, was building the country on the principles that was held by the people who went out to the streets, which is democracy, which is free thinking, justice. But now in these situations, in this where the basic needs are not met for people, we cannot. So it's never not political, if you want to consider those political. It's just the hopes of people who started all of this. But now we had to deal with all of this mess. And also we have to consider working about the governance, about the way of justice, what kind of courts should be in the future, what kind of, how also in the future we should not also be part of disconnecting the country between regime-controlled areas and opposition-controlled areas, how regarding of governance in the asset, how to bring those areas back again, how to, because all of those are Syrians. This is very big questions, and this is our responsibilities as Syrians addressing.
Yes, please. Hi, Ellen Peterson. I'm from the U.S. State Department, and I'll be in Lebanon as of next summer. So I'm curious to know, you referenced a little bit the difficulties of NGOs working for the Syrian people operating in Lebanon. Could you talk a little bit more about, I don't know, I know the Lebanese opinion is very diverse and some are for and some are against and the government's not supporting efforts to stay even somewhat officially in the country, but can you talk a little bit about the obstacles you face and how you overcome them?
Okay. In Lebanon we face lots of obstacles actually, not... The communities, mainly the communities who received Syrian refugees, are the most marginalized communities in Lebanon, like Shatila, like Bekaa, Tripoli. They are also, the host communities are very in a very bad shape. There's lots of needs also in this places. This is one of the main problems. That also, if you're, it's very this took the donors long time to notice. That if you're in Shatila and you're providing like assistance to Syrians, and then the Palestinians will, like, now you're taking all the attention from us, and this will cause problems. Now this issue is considered more, like, most projects are addressing the host community and the refugee communities, which is like releasing the stress between the two of them. And this is on regard of the local community who's receiving the people. On the governmental level, there's the legal status, which is making the life of everyone is really hard. Also the work, because Syrians now are not allowed to work. It's only 10 professions, which is like to be like a daily worker in this, like a farmer, not to own a land, but just to be a worker in a farm. This is also a huge challenge for everyone, because now, like, as Basmeh Zeitooneh, we are almost 200 people in person in Lebanon, but 80% of us are not allowed to work because we're Syrians and Palestinians. We're not allowed legally, we're not allowed to work. And this is we're not able to give any Lebanese will not come work with us because they can easily get employed by any international NGO, because international NGOs, they cannot hire Syrians or Palestinians, like. And this is pushing lots of young guys to leave. Like in our team in 2014, we were like also part of what we do is also focused, like part of our team is the guys who live in the camp. So we also try to work on their capacities, on giving them like computers, giving them English courses, as we hope that they will be part of this, and of building this the country again when we go back. But 31 of them left, choose to go by the boat, by this hideous trip to Greece and then to Europe, because we couldn't guarantee any future for them. We couldn't guarantee that they can go out of the camp because they don't have legal status. They don't have work permit. Whatever money you can, yani, how much, yani, if you gave them even high salaries, it won't be enough because Beirut is really expensive. It's some kind, as some cities in Europe. So this is the challenges that we face in our daily work. Bank accounts. We were able to get to open a bank account, but like for example, we cannot receive anything related to Syria operation in this bank account, because it took us 1 year to register the organization as a Lebanese, because we didn't know that when we applied the paper, we said that we want to work with Syrian refugees. And then after 6 months, they sent it back saying that you cannot mention Syria or Syrians. So we just went back to the papers and just like deleted Syria and Syrians, because this is how it works. The problem that in Lebanon there's no system. There is no like laws. There is, but it's not like in place. So you can always find ways to do things, but it's very chaotic.
Thank you, Reem. We'll take the last two questions, please, from the two ladies.
Hi, I'm Shadi Mokhtari. I teach human rights and Middle East politics at American, and I brought my democratization and political change in the Middle East course here today. I'm going to ask you two political questions, and I completely understand if you're not comfortable answering them. Perhaps I can convince you to talk to my students privately afterwards, but I'll throw them out there for you nonetheless. One question is, if I'm assuming at least one or two of you did participate in the uprising, and now that you see the humanitarian crisis that we're at now, was the uprising worth it, in your opinion? And the second question is, is an outcome of ending the war, but with Assad in power, something that's worth it in terms of the humanitarian cost as well? Again, I understand if these are questions you're not comfortable answering, but wanted to throw them out there for you.
So the first question was if you think it was worth it to participate in the uprising?
The humanitarian cause. If you were to go back in time, which none of us can, of course, but in retrospect, was the uprising worth this tremendous humanitarian cost?
Okay, would you like to take that question?
No, but what's the second question? And
in terms of the future, is it in order to get rid of, to end this humanitarian crisis, having Assad in power, is that an outcome that you think?
I think we both are brave enough.
I'm okay, please go.
Yeah. So, I mean, maybe I have no right because I was at the start of the revolution outside Syria. However, talking to all the staff and the team, it was legitimate. Ask. Everybody has the right to ask for democracy. That's why I left in 2001, even before it gets so bad. So
I know the humanitarian crisis is horrible and everything, but we don't want to be trapped by guilt to say because of the crisis. Everywhere, every revolution, we were reminded yesterday, the French Revolution was at that time, it was very costly. So maybe because now we have all this social media, we see it before, there was no tools to see the what happened during all every revolution. So from that perspective, it doesn't mean we don't sympathize. That's why every day when I'm asked by my family, just come back home, I said, no. I'm staying like my stuff inside Turkey, you know, and Syria. Why should ever, okay, there is a bit of trouble. Oh, are you safe? Do you want to come back? Are you on the plane to come back? No, not because I feel guilt, but I do feel guilt. I'm not going to leave all the stuff because I have the choice to go back to somewhere safe. I'm there to be there for them, you know? And that if that answers your question, so from my personal perspective, yes. And we hope. We know that peace cannot be done without accountability. So the outcome we hope to have a sustainable peace in future Syria, there will be a real peace within an accountable system, you know? And the biggest dictatorship of this crisis is the head of the government, is Al-Assad regime, you know? And him personally, he is responsible. So this is my personal view, and we know that this is the reality. So we hope that one day the international community, those who have interest inside Syria, will decide it is time, and the Syrian people will not give up. That's why when the small window and that paper which was thrown inside Aleppo city, where 250,000 people under the besiegement, they didn't leave. The corridor was open. I know there was no real umbrella. The corridor was open for 3 days by the Russian deal, which was they decided. And they sent in paper, dropping it by the Air Force, leave or you will die. Nobody left. Nobody was holding these people to stay in Aleppo. They've decided to stay. Maybe that's also another part of the answer.
Thank you. If I may comment here, actually, we could rely through this 5 or 6 years praising how this regime criminal is, how he is committed to war crimes and to killing people more than any other thing. And here, actually, we are living abroad now, I've been living abroad since more than 2 years, people under shelling have another decisions. And we have been seeing people making truces with the regime. But it's not fair to say that a man who has been starving and seeing his kids dying from starvation. I lived in besieged areas, and I was I lived in Izguta till May 2014. So I witnessed this besiegement. We ate everything. I couldn't have diapers for my kids. My son was bleeding, not because of the bombing, because we used plastic bags instead of diapers. No one can blame me that time if I accept anything. So I fled out, and I accept to flee out instead of watching I smuggled, instead of watching my kid dying from starvation. I couldn't have baby milk, baby formula for him. And now I cannot blame people inside. But here, actually, I worked in gender-based violence, and one of the red lines was to ask the survival. We named it the survival, not the victim. To ask the survivor, what were you doing at night that time so you were raped? Just because she decided to walk out a little time and to be free to wear whatever she want, she was raped? No, not because of that. Because the world is evil. Because no one wanna stop this. let me tell you something. I've been advocating for protection of health workers since 2 years now. And last year, we started asking for investigation by the UN Security Council about attacks on our facilities, because no one want to believe us, and we are not the expert, and we don't know who is attacking us, and we are trying, as you said, to be in a tool. No, the Russian is attacking us, so let's take sides. I'm not taking the sides of the revolution, I'm taking the side against the criminal here, against the criminal here. Two comments I will never forget. One of them was Staffer in the Congress, and he said, do you believe that your advocacy will bring something here in the Congress? The US, they are involved in Afghanistan attacking hospitals, so don't believe that they want to investigate about attacking hospitals. No one want to do this. No one want to do. And then the Commission of Inquiry, one staffer in the Commission of Inquiry said, do you want another investigation? Seems you didn't read our report. The report is already telling everything. I'm not saying an NGO, the Commission of Inquiry, condemning the Syrian regime, its allies, by details, by date, by location, victims, witnesses, everything. So here we cannot blame people because they said dignity. I participated from the beginning, from the first day. So yeah, I don't feel guilty.
Well, on that note, we have to wrap up. I know some of you still have questions. Please feel free to approach the activists after this session. Mohamad, Reem, and Hivin, I'd like to thank you very much for sharing your thoughts, your emotions, and your personal stories with us. And we hope we'll host you again here at MEI in the future. Please join me in thanking them for being here with us.